Welcome, my dear students, to another session on nutrition. Today, I will be covering the last part of the chapter, macronutrients in food. So let us begin. Today, I will be talking about the significance of the RDA of various macronutrients and the strategies to improve the nutritional profile of a person. So whenever we cook, we always try to follow a recipe in order to get a perfect blend of all the ingredients, to make sure it tastes perfect, and ensure that no ingredient overpowers the other. At the end, if we follow the recipe well, we get a well-balanced dish with impeccable appearance, texture, and flavor. Hence, a recipe acts as a guide. Well, following along those same lines, in nutrition, we need to rely on a set of figures and proportions of nutrients that are needed by our body every day. This is called the recommended dietary allowances, which is abbreviated as RDA. By abiding by these guidelines, we ensure that our body remains in a perfect balance at all times, and we are never affected by a case of malnutrition. So, as you are aware, this chapter of macronutrients is enormous. Hence, I cover this chapter in a series of online sessions. In this teaching session, I will be covering the significance of RDA of various macronutrients. Let us understand the scope of this session. A brief overview of the daily reference intakes, the recommended dietary allowances of macronutrients, dietary guidelines to achieve a healthier life, and myths and concerns associated with nutrition. By the end of this module, you will be able to define the components of dietary reference intakes, assess the importance of RDA, use the recommended dietary allowances to determine the daily nutrient recommendations, and discover certain nutrition facts, and also you will be able to confidently dismiss food-related myths. Let us just recap. Basically, I spoke about the causes and effects of the deficiency and excess of macronutrients in our body and ways to prevent these disease conditions from affecting a person. I had also explained how a person is called malnourished by either being undernourished or overnourished. So malnutrition results when the body does not receive the required amounts of nutrients necessary to keep the body and its systems in good functioning order. So in all the previous sessions, I had provided a detailed insight into what macronutrients are, how they are made, in what foods they are present, how they are digested and absorbed, the several functions in the body, and the consequences of having too much or too little of macronutrients in the diet. This section will provide information on how to determine the recommended amount of macronutrients for a person and the many choices involved in designing an optimal diet with high quality dietary resources. So before I start, I would like you to answer this quiz just to see if you have grasped all the concepts that was taught up till now. So you can take 5 minutes to finish the quiz. Okay, your time starts now. So the first question is, synonymous with the term carbohydrate is the Greek word dash. Okay, well, if you have chosen saccharides, you are absolutely right. Question number two, a measure of the proportion of absorbed protein from a food is called? Okay, have you locked in your answer? If you've answered biological value, give yourself another point. Question three, the two categories of essential fatty acids are? Yes, omega-3 and omega-6. Okay, these are the essential fatty acids. Question 4. Protein is essential in maintaining proper For those that have answered right, it's acid-base balance in the body. Question 5, the last question. Atherosclerosis refers to the buildup of fats, cholesterol, and other substances in and on the artery walls, commonly known as. This one will be easy. Yes, plaque is the right answer. So if you've got all 5 right, please give yourself a pat on the back. Okay, good. Now we need to have a healthy approach towards food. Food helps us to survive, yes, but the right food choices will make sure that the quality of this life improves. So achieving a healthy diet is just a matter of balancing the quality and quantity of food that is eaten. There are 5 key factors that make up a healthy diet. A diet must be adequate by providing sufficient amounts of each nutrient, okay, which is essential. Then do not consume one nutrient at the expense of another, but rather get appropriate amounts of all nutrients. Then calorie control is necessary so that the amount of energy you get from the nutrients you consume equals the amount of energy that you expend throughout the day's activities. Then moderation means not eating to the extremes, neither too much or too little. And the last point about, you know, maintaining a good quality of life from your food is variety, where variety refers to consuming different foods from within each of the food groups on a regular basis. So nature has provided us with so many choices. Let us use it wisely. Okay. Just to summarize, appropriate amounts of nutrients, consumption equals expenditure, and variety of foods. In nutrition, there is a toolkit for a healthy diet. All right. This is the first thing, okay, that is required when we want to plan a diet. So we have recommended dietary allowances, dietary reference intakes, the estimated average requirements, and the tolerable upper limits. Okay, all these are included in dietary reference intakes. So all these tools are values for important nutrients calculated to meet the health needs of different age groups. But long before this dietary toolkit even existed, there were some daily standards that were created. Okay, and these standards were created with the single goal of keeping workers alive and slogging in the factories and the workhouses of the early industrial revolution. So from then on, we have, you know, progressed a lot. And all these dietary references have really made life simple when it comes to choosing the right foods and maintaining a proper diet. So let us understand the daily reference intakes. So DRI, or dietary reference intakes, are the recommendation levels for specific nutrients and consists of a number of different types of recommendations. The DRIs are not minimum or maximum nutritional requirements and are not intended to fit everybody. They are to be used only as guides, okay, for the majority of the healthy population. They are important to help the average person to determine whether their intake of a particular nutrient is adequate. And they are also used by healthcare professionals and the various policymakers to determine nutritional recommendations. So please note that it is not appropriate for people who are ill or malnourished. Now, DRI, or dietary reference intakes, is an umbrella term, okay, and is inclusive of 4 reference values, which are EAR, that is estimated average requirements, RDA, or recommended dietary allowances, adequate intakes, that is abbreviated as AI, and the last one is tolerable upper intake levels, abbreviated as UL. Each DRI value is derived in a different way. Okay, let us see what the first one is all about. Estimated average requirements for a nutrient is determined by a committee of nutrition experts. So they review the scientific literature to determine a value that meets the requirements of 50% of people in their target group within a given life stage and for a particular gender. The requirements of half of the group will fall below the ER and the other half will be above it. It is important to note that for each nutrient, a specific bodily function is chosen as the criteria on which to base the ER. For example, the EAR for calcium is set using a criterion of maximizing bone health. Thus, the EAR for calcium is set at a point that will meet the needs with respect to bone health of half of the population. Okay, so EAR values become the scientific foundation upon which RDA values are set. I will talk about the other two first before we come to RDA. Okay, so adequate intake. Okay, these are created for nutrients when there is insufficient, consistent scientific evidence to set an EAR for the entire population. So AIs can be used as nutrient intake goals for a given nutrient. The AI is meant for a healthy target group and is not meant to be sufficient for certain at-risk groups such as premature infants. The tolerable upper intake levels. Okay, so this is the UL was established to help distinguish healthful and harmful nutrient intakes. Developed in part as a response to the growing usage of dietary supplements, ULs indicate the highest level of continuous intake of a particular nutrient that may be taken without causing health problems. So when a nutrient does not have any known issue, if taken in an excessive dose, it is not given or assigned a UL. However, please remember, even when a nutrient does not have a UL, it is not necessarily safe to consume in large amounts. Okay, there's one more that I just want to mention is the AMDR, which is the acceptable macronutrient distribution ranges. It is the calculated range of how much of energy from carbohydrates, fats, and protein is recommended for a healthy diet. So people who do not reach the AMDRs for their target group increase their risk of developing health complications. Now, what is RDA or recommended dietary allowances? Once the EAR of a nutrient has been established, the RDA can be mathematically determined. So the RDA values are set to meet the needs of the vast majority. That means 97 to 98% of the target healthy population. So we can assume that if a person is daily consuming the RDA of a given nutrient, they are most likely meeting their nutritional need for that nutrient. So it is a very good guideline to understand whether you are within your required range of health or not. In a family, there may be, you know, infants, young children, adolescents, adults, and elderly people all living under one roof. It is always a big challenge to provide a good nutritious diet for each of these members because their needs and preferences differ. So what should be the guiding factor to ensure the balanced meals will be met? Okay, this is the reference or the standard that would serve as a goal for a good nutrition. That means the RDA is the standard. In this section, I will focus on this important concept of RDA or recommended dietary allowances. So humans need a wide range of nutrients to lead a healthy and active life. This depends on age, body weight, physical activity, physiological state, that means pregnancy, lactation, etc. So the minimum amount that needs to be consumed to prevent symptoms of deficiency and to maintain satisfactory level of the nutrient in the body is termed as nutrient requirement. For example, in case of infants and children, the requirement is basically the amount that will maintain a satisfactory rate of growth and development. Similarly, for an adult, the nutrient requirement is the amount that will maintain body weight and prevent the depletion of the nutrient from the body, which otherwise may lead to deficiency. In physiological conditions like pregnancy and lactation, adult women may need additional nutrients to meet the need of the fetal growth, along with their own nutrient needs. So we see here the significance of RDA and how it is used to estimate the probable risk of deficiency among individuals, to modify nutrient requirements, to help the public health nutritionists to compose diets for different schools, hospitals, etc. For healthcare policymakers and public health nutritionists, okay. Then for planning and procuring food supplies for population groups. So RDA is considered after considering the requirement and the safety margin. That's how we calculate the RDA. Then it is also required for interpreting food consumption records of individuals and populations, establishing standards, designing nutrition education programs for the masses, also developed new products, okay, and dietary supplements. So for this also you require the RDA, to establish guidelines for the national labeling of packaged goods. Okay, so this is a comprehensive list of all the uses of RDA. Next, let us learn about the RDA for Indians. So here I have the 2010 dietary guidelines, which show that protein, carbohydrates and lipids, okay, have to be consumed in a particular percentage, and this is what it is. So in a day, 5 to 20%, okay, for children should be the protein requirements. Then we see the carbohydrate requirement and the lipid requirement. So recommended dietary allowances for the Indian population. This is the entire table, which shows you how much you need per day. In the case of energy, RDA represents only the average daily requirements corresponding to daily average energy expenditure of an individual. So we have divided, okay, the three different categories of men, okay, the sedentary workers, the moderate and the heavy workers. Depending on their physical activity, that shows the RDA. The RDA for protein is based on the body weight, if you can notice. And RDA for energy and protein are given as additional intakes in pregnancy and lactation, indicated by a positive sign. This requirement is over and above the normal requirement of adult women. Okay, so you've seen for women, say for example, protein is 55, over and above you add 23 more grams of protein per day. So wherever it's plus, it's added. Okay, not physically active means a lifestyle that only includes basic movements from daily life activities. That means sedentary work. Moderately active means a lifestyle that adds about 1.5 to 3 miles of brisk walking per day, or a similar amount of a different physical activity. And active means a lifestyle that adds more than 3 miles of brisk walking per day, and of course heavy work, okay, or a similar amount of a different physical activity. So other physical activities include jogging, dancing, tennis, swimming, etc., which are also helpful in understanding how much you actually require. So there is a program called the Choose My Plate program that uses a tailored approach to give people the needed information to help design a healthy diet. The plate is divided according to the amount of food and nutrients you should consume for each meal. So each food group is identified with a different color, showing the food variety that all plates must have. Okay, see how colorful it should look. Besides this, the food pyramid is also an excellent guide, and we will be learning about the food pyramid in another chapter. So nowadays, more people tend to buy foods which are in the processed form. Okay, if you go to the supermarket, it is filled with a lot of processed foods. This is because it is a convenient way of eating, I suppose. So all packaged foods that are sold must have nutrition labels that accurately reflect the contents of the food products and provides a wealth of information about the nutritional content of the product. On nutrition food labels, the amount given for calories is actually equivalent to each calorie multiplied by 1000. A kilocalorie, that means 1000 calories denoted with a small c, is synonymous or identical with the calorie, that means calorie with a big C. Okay, and this is all found on nutritional labels. The information also shows, you know, shoppers a way to compare products. So whenever you go shopping, please make sure when you choose something, please go through these labels. The serving sizes are included on the labels. Okay, you can see how much of each nutrient is in each serving to make the comparison. So for example, a bag of peanuts at a grocery store may seem like a healthy snack to eat on the way to, you know, class or wherever. But have a look at the label if it contains one serving or multiple servings. So unless you are buying the individual serving packages, chances are that the bag that you picked up is at least, you know, 8 or 10 servings. To achieve the goal of reduced calorie intake, the 2010 dietary guidelines promote the following. First one, increase intake of whole grains, fruit and vegetables of various colors. The reason being to get the benefit of as many different vegetables and fruits as you can. So identify which vegetables and fruits are in season and local to your area. By consuming the in-season or local foods, you cut down on, you know, various costs. That means, you know, transportation costs, etc. And you are likely to get fresher produce. And you also support your local farmers by purchasing their produce. Get more daily carbohydrate servings from whole grains by eating a whole grain cereal for breakfast or whole grain or multigrain bread. Chapati, having brown rice for lunch and, you know, or dinner, and eating a serving of beans and nuts with your meals. When baking, use whole wheat flour or other whole grain flour instead of refined flour. You can add a lot of, you know, nice seeds like flax seeds, nuts, etc. to the salads because they add texture and taste. Experience the taste and satisfaction of also other whole grains such as barley, quinoa, bulgur, etc. Eat snacks that are high in fiber like almonds, pistas or pistachios, raisins and air popped popcorn. Then you can also satisfy your sweet tooth by eating fruit such as berries or an apple, etc. Or even peaches are very tasty. Replace sugary soft drinks with natural lemon and mint drinks, you know, green tea or 100% fruit juice. And reduce the intake of sweet and other desserts and pastries. High consumption of certain food, this is the second point, high consumption of certain foods such as those high in saturated or trans fats, sodium, etc., may contribute to the increased incidence of chronic disease. So fat calories should be obtained by eating foods high in unsaturated fatty acids. Cholesterol intake should be decreased to below 300 milligrams per day, and the trans fatty acid composition or consumption should be kept to a bare minimum. Okay, so replace butter with oils, the healthy oils. For dairy products, eat the low-fat versions. When selecting meats, be aware of the need to compare different types of cuts. Okay, you can notice that the fat content, the color, and the marbling effect on these meats before buying. So higher fat meats tend to have whiter fat marbled throughout. So you see the white design inside the meats, that's the marbling effect. Choose lean cuts and white meat as these are lower in saturated fat. The third point, don't get your protein only from red meats. Choose a lot of seafood, poultry, eggs, beans, peas, nuts, you know, seeds, soya products, and even quinoa. These are very good sources of protein. Healthy food shifts. So you can move towards a healthier eating pattern by making shifts in food choices over time. So here are just a few ideas that I have got from the US Department of Agriculture. So there are these 100 calorie snacks that you get, you know, you can get. Another way to think about the idea of nutrient dense and calorie dense foods is to look at a variety of foods that all provide the same calories. So let's take, for example, you wanted to have a little snack. So you might choose a 7-inch banana or a normal banana size, 20 peanuts, or 3 cups of low fat popcorn, or 2 regular chocolate sandwich cookies, or 1/2 cup of low fat ice cream, 1 scrambled egg, which is cooked in fat, 60 grams of baked chicken breast with no skin, and 1/2 of the average size of a candy bar. Now, these are all the choices, which all have about 100 calories, but provide different amounts of nutrients. So the choice is yours, which one, you know, you would feel, based on all the nutrition information I've given you, which one would you choose as a snack? So what I do is for the last point, you know, you can see here, over here, experiment with reducing the amount of sugar. So while baking, what I do is instead of adding too much of sugar, I add dates or I add banana to the recipe, you know, which supplements and substitutes. Okay, it substitutes the sugar content and gives you a lot of other nutrients. So it supplements your meal. Seltzer is basically water carbonated with added carbon dioxide. Okay, so if you don't like, or we call it soda here, it is, if you mix it with 100% fruit juice, you can get and satisfy that need for fizzy drinks. These are some other ideas. Okay, very interesting shifts from high calorie snacks to nutrient dense snacks. And then we have fruit products with added sugars. You know, although they say Fruit Loops and all, we feel it's got a lot of fruit in it, but it's just the processed versions. Okay, very interesting. So like that, you can see all the different foods that you have in your house, the processed versions, and see what else you can substitute it with so that you get more nutrients instead. So I just want to show you a couple of videos where dietitians will debunk myths and also address certain concerns in nutrition. Okay, so that was one video and you can watch the other one because it's also very interesting. So I have a learning activity for you. What you need to do is you have to make a short informational video of yourself. All right. So the duration of the video should be around 10 to 15 minutes. You can make the video on your own. Okay. Or you can use the help of your friends or family. And you can do it in your house or you can do it anywhere outside. You can use a nice backdrop, you know, or a nice scene. So in the video, you have to cover 2 aspects. Importance of macronutrients in food, 10 local foods or ingredients available in your locality which are high in carbohydrates, protein, and lipids, and then what dishes you can make from these local foods. All right, so the 2 aspects are the importance, and then I need to know the local foods. You will need to show the picture of the food item or the real food item if you have it in the house while speaking about it. So for example, Tinder, so I've used the example, I put a picture and some information is given. So you can, you know, speak about this. You don't have to write it down on any PowerPoint presentation and you can show the picture of it or you can show the real food I do. Just to summarize, well, now that you have gained a wealth of information and food for thought to enable you to make changes in your dietary pattern, I hope that your desire to pursue a healthy life has been, you know, solidified, and you have become more serious about improving your health. So a healthy eating pattern is not a rigid prescription, so please remember that. It is a framework that lets you enjoy food that meets your personal preferences and also fits your budget. So in the next teaching session, we are going to be doing the micronutrients in food. So I will be starting with the overview and significance of micronutrients in food. To end, I would like to put up this caption and say that the doctor of the future will no longer treat the human frame with drugs, but rather will cure and prevent disease with nutrition. This was Thomas Edison's words, and I found this lovely picture. All right, my dear students, I hope you enjoyed this session and the entire chapter. I hope you have understood everything and all the concepts and the facts and the figures related to it. Have a very good day.